My name is Anastasia Banashak, and I'm a researcher here at the Reef Systems Academic Unit of the National Autonomous University of Mexico in Puerto Morelos. I've developed a coral reproduction and reef restoration project. This project is basically about trying to help in the restoration of coral reefs. Coral reefs are very important, especially in the Mexican Caribbean, because they are a source of both protein for the local inhabitants, as well as a source of income for them through the tourism potential that they generate. And also because there's fishing practices that go on here, so it's an important source of income for the local community. As structures, they're also extremely important for the environment. They provide a lot of habitat for many different species. Coral reefs are very diverse, and one of the reasons they can be diverse is because the corals provide a wonderful habitat where species can hide and can reproduce and be safe from predators. They also provide protection for the coast because especially there's one species, Acropora palmata, which is known as elkhorn coral, which absorbs up to 99% of the energy that comes from waves due to storms or hurricanes. By absorbing all that energy, it doesn't reach the coast. That means they reduce beach erosion and also obviously protect hotels and houses that are along the shoreline. The success of this project is based on the fact that we have many collaborations. For example, we have the collaboration with Seacor International, we have collaboration with many different aquariums, Xcaret Aquarium here in Mexico, as well as many aquariums from the United States. We have a lot of students that come in to learn about these techniques. We also have collaborations with government agencies, such as the National Parks Authority.
Soy María del Carmen García Rivas, directora del Parque Nacional Arrecife de Puerto Morelos, adscrito a la CONAR. Soy bióloga y mi trabajo básicamente es conservar y desarrollar sustentable estos arrecifes a través de las actividades turísticas y pesqueras que tenemos en el área. Bueno, yo he tenido la oportunidad de ver estos arrecifes de Puerto Morelos. Mi primer práctica de biología de campo fue acá, estuve 20 días monitoreando coral y bueno, era un acuario, básicamente había muchísimos peces, una coloración maravillosa y sí, yo he visto cómo pues desgraciadamente estos arrecifes se han deteriorado, han perdido esos colores que para mí son indicadores de salud. Y pues he visto también cómo se ha desarrollado la costa abruptamente. Es uno de los sitios en el mundo donde hay un desarrollo y un arribo de personas mayor. Y bueno, también he visto cómo la gente ha tenido mayor conciencia y se ha responsabilizado más ante el cuidado del medio ambiente, y esto es muy importante.
I'm Dirk Peterson, the founder and executive director of Seacor International. If corals get under stress, one of the first things that happens is that they stop reproduction. They just don't have the energy available to produce all these gametes, eggs and sperm, because they try to survive. Restoration alone will not help corals to survive, but restoration can be a very important tool to add to the toolbox of managing, conserving coral reefs. So if we give them a helping hand to overcome these very first initial fragile life stages, we can help them to reproduce again. So far, most restoration attempts in the Caribbean have been done with asexual reproduction, which is fragmentation. So you simply break a piece off a coral, glue it to a substrate, leave it in a nursery for some time to recover and grow, and then you transplant those asexual recruits or fragments to the reef. This has been an important step, initial step, but in order to look into genetic diversity, to maintain genetic diversity, to prepare corals for the future climate scenario, we need to look into sexual reproduction. Genetic diversity or sexual reproduction is essential for any species, because only through genetic recombination a species, a population, is able to adapt to a changing environment.
Spawning is a unique event. It happens only on one or two or maybe three nights a year during the summer months, normally in August, and a few nights after full moon. So we use the date of the full moon to then calculate when we think coral spawning will occur. In branching species like Acropora palmata or the elkhorn coral, they can fragment. When a storm goes through, a coral can fragment into some pieces. But there's also another way that they reproduce, and that's because they produce eggs and sperm, which they release into the water column and in packets. And these packets will float to the surface and then break up, and then with other unrelated colonies, they'll fertilize and produce embryos. These embryos will develop into larvae. The larvae float for a while along in the current, and then they will start diving and looking for a substrate to settle on. And so once they settle, they go through a process called metamorphosis. They metamorphose into a coral polyp, and then they start producing a coral skeleton, and then slowly they'll start dividing and producing a coral colony.
Soy Rodolfo Raigosa, estoy a cargo del área de fauna en el grupo Xcaret. Dentro de Xcaret está el acuario y en el acuario tenemos el proyecto de corales. Bueno, el acuario desde que se formó a principios de Xcaret, desde 1993, inició con un programa para tener corales en estanques artificiales. Y el trabajo con corales inició desde entonces. Empezamos con los corales blandos y en los últimos años hemos estado trabajando con los corales duros. En especial ahora con Acropora palmata tenemos la gran ventaja de tener una excelente calidad de agua porque la tomamos prácticamente de la costa y tenemos buena calidad de agua ahí. Por lo tanto, nuestros sistemas son muy buenos para este tipo de proyectos, y además la gente que se ha formado durante mucho tiempo en el manejo de organismos marinos, en especial de corales, que desde el principio iniciamos con el trabajo de corales en el acuario.
Mi nombre es Ana Cerón, trabajo aquí en el Parque Xcaret en el Departamento de Ecología Acuática. Es el cooperativo de los parques Experiencias Xcaret. Uno de los proyectos en los cuales estoy involucrada directamente es el proyecto de conservación de corales. Salimos al mar 4 noches, esperar que haya el desove, pero mientras ocurre el desove, nosotros antes de esto también construimos unas trampas especiales. Las trampas son de una tela que es muy suave. Colocamos unos plomos o peso en las orillas y básicamente lo colocamos sobre una colonia, y esta boya pues hace que flote En esta parte de aquí colocamos unos frascos de plástico. Los buzos son los que se encargan de hacer todo este proceso cuando empiezan a ver el setting, que es la preparación del pólipo para vaya a expulsar el paquete de gametos. Colocan la trampa y el buzo coloca el vaso. Y los gametos flotan, tienen muchos lípidos, lo que hace es que por el embudo pasen y se quedan aquí en la parte de arriba, en la parte de la superficie. Es un proceso que tienen que hacer ellos de una manera rápida. Cuando ellos colocan la trampa, colocan el vaso y este vaso ellos lo tienen en una bolsa. Este lo pasan rápidamente y ponen el otro vaso y este lo colocan aquí. Y este vaso se lo pasan a un snorkel.
We collect these egg and sperm bundles and then we take them to the boat and do in vitro fertilization in the boat, just basically mixing these bundles that come from different colonies that are unrelated, and we put them together. They're the same species but they're unrelated. We put them together in containers and basically promote the fertilization process just by moving the whole mixture that we have. And so that basically promotes the encounter between sperm and eggs. We bring that mixture into the lab and we clean out all of the sperm and the predators that love to come and eat the eggs because it's a delicious feast for them. We put the now developing embryos into culture. Once they develop into larvae, we give them substrates that have been designed by Secor International. We let these larvae settle down onto these substrates. We need to have really high survival of the cultures that we have growing right now and a high rate of settlement onto the substrates, which we pretty much get every year. So we're pretty good at knowing what conditions we need to have for that. And then we need to put them out onto reefs that are degraded or in process of degradation and hope that they survive and start growing into juvenile corals.
Mi nombre es Sergio Wendulain. Trabajo como técnico en un proyecto de restauración con la doctora Anastasia Banashak dentro de la Universidad Nacional Autónoma de México. Mi trabajo dentro del proyecto es apoyar en la recolecta de gametos de coral y también está relacionado con la producción, el acondicionamiento, el asentamiento de larvas de coral en bases de asentamiento y la reintroducción de estas al arrecife. Esta es una base de asentamiento recientemente introducida por Secor. Básicamente tiene forma de tetrápodo y esto facilita el anclado al arrecife sin la necesidad de utilizar pegamento o ningún tipo de cemento. Esto reduce en gran medida los costos de producción y el tiempo que se requiere para trabajar. Estas bases de asentamiento son producidas en el laboratorio con unos moldes que nos facilita Secor y después de eso son introducidas a un lugar cerca del arrecife en el mar. Para acondicionarlas. Básicamente lo que necesitamos es que crezcan algas coralinas incrustantes sobre las bases, lo que hace más atractiva a estas bases para las larvas. Esto nos ayuda mucho en el asentamiento de las larvas. Estos sustratos, una vez que tienen las larvas asentadas, son llevados al arrecife en contenedores de plástico con agua y a través de buceo se introducen manualmente tratando de sujetarlos a las estructuras naturales del arrecife, a los recovecos. Se introducen manualmente y en una densidad aproximada de 4 bases por metro cuadrado. Una vez que introducimos las bases de asentamiento, a los 2 meses básicamente ya están cubiertas de algas coralinas, se integran al paisaje del arrecife y si no los buscas, es bastante difícil reconocerlos.
You using sexual reproduction in restoration may have the great benefit that you can upscale restoration efforts, which are urgently needed. So if you look at sexual reproduction, it does not matter if you're dealing with 100 larvae or 1,000 or 1,000,000 or 10 million larvae. Because once you know how a larvae of a specific coral species settles, which conditions are needed, you can provide those conditions and the larvae will settle by themselves. So in this way, you can actually produce hundreds of thousands, millions of coral. So we are working on developing technology to upscale restoration, to automize these processes.
My name is Aaron Jeske. I am a zookeeper at the Columbus Zoo and Aquarium. I'm here for SeaCorps not only because I love corals and conservation, but also because the Columbus Zoo and Aquarium has been a main supporter of SeaCorps since its inception. Behind me, you see these large pools back here to produce many more larvae and many more baby corals that can help put back onto the reef and help in restoration efforts. So once we collect the gametes for the baby corals and they're fertilized and we actually have a baby coral, they're normally put into a much smaller bin where they're cared for about 48 to 72 hours, and then they start settling on tiles where we can eventually put them back in the reef. On a small scale like that, we can only do so many at a time. So we basically increase the size. We still have a much larger volume, but the idea is the same. We put a certain density of coral larvae in these systems so they're not too packed and they still have adequate water flow. And eventually, once they get old enough, they'll start looking for a place to settle, and hopefully those are on our tiles that we can put back into the ocean. We want to keep construction as simple as possible. The idea is that these systems can be used in very remote locations with very little resources. So the systems behind us are made out of PVC and other things that are readily available at hardware stores. These are designed to be deployed in the ocean, deployed where there's very little resources, and that way we can help restoration efforts anywhere in the world, technically.
It takes many people with many different types of expertise to do this, from engineers through to coral biologists through to people who know about in vitro fertilization. So what we've been trying to do is to be a center here in Puerto Morelos where people come and collaborate with us and try to help to restore coral reefs. So there's a saying that to raise a child, it takes a village. And my belief is that to restore reefs, it will take many villages. My vision is that in the future, we will have many people working to restore coral reefs and using sexual coral reproduction to do so, to help have a high genetic diversity of corals and help them to survive all the climate change conditions that they're going to be receiving in the next coming decades. My vision is to teach as many people as possible. Originally, my dream was to have a national program. It's now developed into an international program. In the future, I hope that we can include many other people to work on this dream of restoring reefs and giving them a future.
Viable que sirva para tener arrecifes sanos en el futuro.
Nosotros cuidamos los arrecifes para el futuro.
Es por eso que le damos a los arrecifes de coral un futuro.
Demos un futuro a los arrecifes de coral.
And that's how we try to give coral reefs a future.
Yeah, so I think with collaborating with all of the partners that we have, we can give coral reefs a future.
SeaCorps International aims at giving coral reefs a future.